You probably know Ethernet and might have heard cars use something called CAN, but do you know how they compare? Both CAN, the Controller Area Network Protocol, and Ethernet are found in settings such as automotive, medical systems, and industrial automation. They both achieve essentially the same goal, interconnecting different devices and enabling those devices to communicate. Both are also layer 1 and 2 network protocols responsible for node-to-node data transfer and error checking. Bosch developed CAN in the 1980s specifically to support the growing number of computers in a car. At the time, Ethernet was primarily suited to office and computing environments and was not yet adapted to meet the specific needs of automotive systems. Over the years, however, Ethernet technology has evolved and is becoming more prominent in modern cars, particularly for systems that require higher bandwidth like infotainment systems and advanced driver assistance systems. Let's compare 5 different strengths and weaknesses of CAN and Ethernet in automotive. 1. The physical wire and data rates. CAN uses a single twisted pair of wires and can operate at speeds up to 1 megabit per second. A newer extension called CAN-FD extends that up to 15 megabits per second. Ethernet can also use a single pair of wires, but typically uses 4 or 8 wires instead. 4 wires supports up to 100 megabits per second, and 8 wires supports all the way up to 10 gigabits per second. 2. Network flow and congestion control. CAN comes with half duplex communication and no real congestion control. Half duplex means that a device can either send or receive, but can't do both simultaneously. No congestion control means there is no way to manage or mitigate the impact of network traffic congestion once the network's capacity is exceeded. Ethernet supports full duplex flow control, so devices can both send and receive simultaneously. Ethernet includes superior congestion control, including collision detection and carrier sense multiple access, so that devices know when the line is free and even have the ability to ask neighboring devices to pause transmission. 3. Network addressing. CAN and Ethernet differ on how different devices on the network communicate with each other. CAN uses identifiers that describe the message priority and purpose, but there is no specific identifier for a device. A sender essentially adds a message ID and broadcasts the message on the bus, while receivers filter all bus messages to only those IDs they care about. Ethernet uniquely identifies each device on the network with a MAC address, enabling both broadcast and the ability to directly send data to a specific recipient. 4. Prioritization and quality of service. CAN shines when you have a short message and need real-time performance. In CAN, data frames can be up to 8 bytes, with the new CAN-FD extensions allowing up to 64 bytes. The message priority is encoded directly in the message ID field, where lower numerical values correspond to higher priorities. That means if 2 nodes begin communicating at the same time, the node with the lowest identifier has the highest priority and will win the arbitration and continue to send while the other backs off. Ethernet frames, however, can carry a whopping 1,500 bytes by default, and even more if jumbo frames are enabled. Prioritization and quality of service is handled through IEEE 802.1Q, which introduces VLAN tagging and priority fields in messages. Ethernet can also meet real-time guarantees through the time-sensitive networking standard. Overall, CAN messages are relatively short, and that short size minimizes the time each message occupies on the bus and reduces overall delays before other messages can be sent. Ethernet's larger frames allow packets to carry more information, which is better for information-heavy services. 5. Security and application development. CAN requires special network support drivers and libraries on most OSs. On Linux, a popular choice is the vCAN kernel module and the SocketCAN library. SocketCAN allows applications to send and receive data over a normal Unix raw socket. Now, it's important to note that CAN-oriented development does not assume or typically include the presence of higher-level protocols like TCP/IP and provides no built-in security. So if you need reliable communications or built-in security features, CAN isn't the best choice. Ethernet boasts high interoperability and compatibility across a vast range of operating systems and network environments. In addition, Ethernet assumes the utility and integration with higher-level protocols like TCP/IP, and developers typically use those higher-level protocols to read and write data rather than dealing with raw Ethernet frames or sockets directly. Unlike CAN, Ethernet supports a wide range of security protocols at various layers, including encryption, authentication, and network access control. And it also enables better security at the application level as well. The TLDR is CAN provides inherent real-time capabilities with its arbitration and error handling features, making it ideal for low data rate, high reliability environments where immediate response is crucial. These environments typically also use weaker embedded devices with single purpose-built software like deploying an airbag. Ethernet has much higher data rates with reasonable real-time performance, making it especially attractive for modern high-bandwidth services like autonomous driving and infotainment. These environments typically also need faster, modern computers running a full-blown operating system and software stack. So there you have it, CAN versus Ethernet. Now at For All Secure, whether you're using the CAN bus or you're using the Ethernet network, our job is to help you protect the software that runs on top. We build tools that help you build more reliable software, get better coverage, and find those new zero-day vulnerabilities with zero false positives before attackers do. Try us out by going to mayhem.security.